ever since September 11th, 2001, the United States has confronted a new reality. Terrorist groups, many of whom are fueled by religious fervor, have declared a holy war on the United States, and they have killed thousands of people within our own borders, as well as initiating attacks on the United States and its interests at home and abroad in other ways. Since that same date, the country has wrestled with how to deal with alleged terrorists who are detained by military forces or other agents of the United States. And it is that topic that we will briefly touch on today. Because of the unusual nature of what happened on 9/11, a newly muscular executive branch and a strong response from the judiciary and to some degree from the legislature, we have a whole new climate in which to deal with these issues. And they continue. At this moment, the United States is still trying to decide where and how to try Khalid Sheikh Mohammed. They are debating whether the so-called Christmas shoe bomber on flight, whatever it was, from I think Northwest Airlines, should have been Mirandized, and whether a person who was 15 years of age when he was captured in Afghanistan should be tried before a military court. We're very fortunate to have a very distinguished panel of experts who will address some portion of these issues. As you can appreciate, this is a subject you could discuss for years, indeed many have, and it will go on. But I think that you will find that our panelists today will spark your interest and enlighten you in areas that perhaps you have never considered. Our chair today, our moderator, is Professor Jack Goldsmith, professor at Harvard Law School, and also previously the head of the Office of Legal Counsel in the Department of Justice. He is also, I understand, a former law clerk of Justice Kennedy, who's watching him carefully today. Judge Leonie Brinkema, who is a United States District Judge from the Eastern District of Virginia, who has presided over several terrorism trials, including one that will be discussed at some length today, and that is of Zacarias Moussaoui. Professor Elizabeth Hillman, Professor of Law at the Hastings School of Law at the University of California, who is an expert in military law and military tribunals, who will add a lot about that element of the problem. And then two gentlemen, Ed McMahon, who was the lead defense lawyer in the Moussaoui trial, and Rob Spencer, who was the AUSA in the same trial. We look forward to hearing from our distinguished panelists. They will each make brief presentations, have an interplay, and then we will have about 20 minutes for questions at the end. So I'll turn it over now to Professor Goldsmith.
Thank you very much, Judge Smith, and thank you so much for inviting me here to be on this wonderful panel today. As Judge Smith said, we're nearly 9 years after 9/11. We're coming up on the ninth anniversary. And as a nation, we still have not figured out, indeed, I think we haven't begun to figure out what to do, how to incarcerate and incapacitate alleged terrorists. The Bush administration and in the last year and a half, the Obama administration as well, they've committed themselves to three different systems of for incapacitating or incarcerating terrorists. The first, and the one that we're going to focus on mostly today, is civilian trials, using the ordinary criminal justice system to try, convict, and incarcerate alleged terrorists. Civilian courts have been used to try literally hundreds of terrorists and those related to acts of terrorism in the last couple of decades. So this is a true-and-try system, but it's a system that some people think is not adequate to dealing with the threat and the challenge after 9/11. So the government has developed, in addition to the civilian criminal system, which is still used quite a great deal to try terrorists, has developed two other systems. One is a system of military commissions. Military commissions have a long history in the United States. They've been used in wartime in many of our wars These are traditionally Article II courts in the sense that they were self-contained military justice systems. They were used most prominently, I believe, Beth is going to talk about this more, I think, in the Civil War and in World War II. They became very controversial after 9/11 when President Bush in November of 2001 announced, without consulting Congress, that he was going to use military commissions. We've had a giant debate in this country in the last 8-9 years about their proper use. And Congress has twice weighed the Supreme Court weighed in the spring of 2006 in a case called Hamdan, invalidating the original Bush military commission scheme as inconsistent with some congressional restrictions. Congress responded to that in the fall of 2006 in the Military Commissions Act of 2006 to basically codify military commission with some non-trivial changes to the Bush program and putting Congress's stamp on it. The Obama administration made additional adjustments that Congress ratified last year. So we now have Congress having twice weighed in on military commissions, but as a system, they haven't worked very well at all. They've had political problems, they've had legal problems. Nonetheless, that's another option that the Obama administration is using to deal with terrorists. And the third one, and the one that's been relied on most heavily, I believe, is military detention. And this too is a basis for incapacitating terrorists that has been used in prior wars. The idea here is, as Justice O'Connor explained in her plurality opinion in the Hamdi case in 2004, is that during wartime, a nation has the power to detain a member of the enemy armed forces and for the duration of the conflict, simply for the reason to incapacitate the person and keep the person from returning to the battlefield. And that is a power that traditionally extends to the end of the conflict. That traditional power has been used and it has been approved by courts in various guises, but it raises all sorts of questions in this war because the conflict may last and likely will last indefinitely, because the members of the enemy don't in this war are harder to distinguish from innocent civilians, and so the ordinary processes for determining who's a member of the enemy armed forces are sometimes inadequate. In any event, all three of these systems, civilian trials, military commissions, and military detention, have been used by the government. And the government has basically engaged in what I think is fair to call an ad hoc or more or less ad hoc process of deciding which system to use in which circumstances. This was certainly the Bush administration's position, and as far as I can tell, it's the Obama administration's position as well. Assistant Attorney General David Crist gave a speech in the spring in which he basically said that the president should use every tool in his toolbox, and these are three different tools that would be used for different circumstances. So we're going to be focusing on this panel primarily on civilian trials because our panel has expertise in that, because that's the sort of baseline against which these other systems are measured. I just want to raise a couple of framing points, and then I'm going to turn it over to the panel. The first one is that Congress has been engaged in military commissions in theory, but Congress has not really been engaged either on military detention much or on civilian trials. And mostly what's going on in both of those two fora is a dialogue between the executive branch and the judiciary. That's what we've been doing for the last 8 or 9 years. And I think it's fair to say that the courts have asserted an extraordinary and unprecedented role in this war in being much, much more heavily involved in reviewing the president's wartime actions with regard to detainees than ever in the past. And mostly this is a dialogue between the president and the courts. The second point I want to make before turning it over to our panelists is, and I think this frames the use of civilian trials, is that the Bush administration and the Obama administration both have asserted, Attorney General Holder most recently, that if a terrorist is acquitted at trial, and if that person is deemed dangerous and is deemed to be an enemy combatant, that the government has the authority nonetheless, even after acquittal, to detain the person indefinitely on the military detention rationale. And so this, of course, raises the question whether it's a genuine trial if the person is going to be incarcerated nonetheless if acquitted. With those framing remarks, I'm going to turn it over to our panel. We're going to go down the panel this way, starting with Beth, who's going to give us some historical perspective, Rob and Ed, who are going to talk about the prosecutorial and defense perspectives in the Moussaoui trial and more general in civilian terrorism trials, and then Judge Brinkema, who's going to give us the judicial perspective on terrorism trials. So with that, we'll turn it over. The panelists will speak for about 8 minutes, and then we'll have a discussion amongst ourselves, and then we'll turn it over to you. Thanks.
Like Jack, I'd like to thank Judge Smith and the conference committee that put this together. I'm surprised that we're here to talk about this, in part because it seems a long time that we've been hashing over these issues, and in part because my chosen field of study in American legal history, I did not expect to become more than a sort of niche issue in the study of American law as compared to the bombshell that it's become in recent years. When I started to write a dissertation about U.S. military justice 10 years ago, at best, military law was a sideshow in American legal history. It's not that anymore. It's now being integrated into the great narratives of American law, into the ebb and flow of constitutional interpretation, into the rise of federal authority and the nationalization of our law, the growth of rights jurisprudence, the balance of power among the branches of government. Now, military operations and the law of war has always been a part of those themes in American legal history, but today we recognize that in a different way because of the very issue we're talking about today, the question of what to do with a specific group of persons accused of crimes with these competing systems available to try them. So I don't have to belabor the point that military commissions are not new. We have many judicial opinions that actually do that quite elegantly for us. I don't have to say that military law and operations create difficult procedural issues that make us question the meaning of due process and how to parse the different categories of persons to whom we will offer varieties of due process. Instead, as one of the historians on the stage today at least, I'd like to give you some details from military commissions past to highlight the role that the law and politics have played in some of our prior instances of military commissions and threats to the nation that have precipitated new forums in which to try crimes against the state. I'd also like to remind you, before I close today, of the impact that the commissions have had on the U.S. legal system within our armed forces. There aren't any judge advocates on the panel today, and we don't have folks from within the military. But of all the groups within American law that the commission structure has affected, it's our judge advocates who are laboring in the trenches, trying to navigate these very confusing waters of what's happening with these military commissions. Jack mentioned that the two instances in our past that you know about where we have most used military commissions have been the Civil War and World War II. So let me just take a couple of instances to remind you of some of the high-profile cases during that time and talk about the details of those trials briefly. First, the Civil War. Lots of military commissions, military tribunals took place during this time, nearly 6,000 during the war and Reconstruction. The authority to try persons before military commissions outlasted hostilities themselves. They also didn't only take place in the battlefield between Union and Confederate troops or in occupied territories. One of the most celebrated of the military commissions that took place, in fact, during the war was on the frontier. In 1862, an uprising of four of the Sioux tribes in Minnesota, in which more than 400 settlers and American soldiers and Dakota soldiers who were working with the American troops were killed. There was a mass trial of the Sioux who were charged with those crimes that took place very quickly in a summary justice sort of way on the frontier, and those records of trials were sent to President Lincoln to review in the midst of the Civil War. Now, when Lincoln got those records, he asked his attorney general for guidance. His attorney general said, "You're on your own, Mr. President." He said, "You can't delegate the authority to review these records. It must be done by the president." So Lincoln, being Lincoln, reviewed all those records. There were 303 death sentences that had been adjudged. He approved only 39 of those. And in fact, in that commission itself, which is much denigrated for its procedural irregularities, there was an 18% acquittal rate. 18% of the Sioux who were sent to that trial were acquitted. My point in raising that is to say that it is possible that a commission, a military commission, undertaken under a situation of exigency, cannot be the caricature of justice that we sometimes assume it to be, and that the political and military objectives that are served by that commission can sometimes be managed within the context of executive review and the clemency that happens afterwards. And you know, Lincoln undertook that review after the general in the field wrote this letter to him. He wrote, "If the guilty are not all executed, I think it nearly impossible to prevent the indiscriminate massacre of all the Indians, old men, women, and children, who are now being held as prisoners." And that was 1,500 Sioux who were being held by American forces on the frontier at that point. The general in the field said, "I can't keep my men from killing them if you don't execute all of these convicted men right now." But Lincoln didn't, and the massacre did not ensue. Okay, one other example from the Civil War, and that's the trial of the conspirators who assassinated President Lincoln, or were convicted of that conspiracy to assassinate Lincoln. On April 9th, 1865, Lee surrendered to Grant at Appomattox. On April 14th, John Wilkes Booth assassinated President Lincoln. President Andrew Johnson faced difficult decisions. How to try these men, whether to make the trial secret, what should happen. He intended for the trial to be secret for the eight conspirators. General Grant convinced him not to do that. Another example of the role that generals sometimes play in the political and legal decisions that are being made. Those accused persons, eight of them, were brought into court staggering, chained, wrapped in black linen. They were convicted quickly by a panel of officers, and they were sentenced to hang. Only four of the death sentences were approved. So even in that instance, not all of the death sentences were actually carried out, and that was still when the country was still in a state of martial law in many places that had yet to be lifted. Okay, let's set the Civil War aside and let me snap forward to World War II for just a brief comment. We are right now in the place where the most military commissions were held during the war. Hawaii was under martial law for 15 months during World War II. And mostly provost courts rather than military commissions were held here to keep the peace, but many were held with many procedural irregularities under their auspices. The best known trial of World War II, though, that is relevant to the terrorism trials that we're talking about today, is the trial of the Nazi saboteurs. And you know that story. Nazis sent submarines with saboteurs armed and ready to attack the United States. They landed outside of Jacksonville. They landed on Long Island. They were led by a very incompetent and troubled man who spent most of his time playing pinochle and drinking in New York before he decided to go to the FBI and turn them in. But for that happenstance, we might not have caught them. But we did catch them. President Roosevelt wanted to get them prosecuted quickly and get the death penalty available, and he did that in a trial that has led to some questionable precedents. Okay, the last thing I just want to mention here, and that's about the impact on the military judiciary, the military legal core today. The relative costs of trying persons in civilian versus military courts are hard to pin down exactly. These are high-profile criminal trials. They will be expensive. The Ninth Circuit is no stranger to expensive trials. The Ninth Circuit has seen plenty of those in recent years and in the past. But in military commissions, let me just mention that the military legal court is spending lots of its energy on these cases. There are about 4,000 judge advocates today. Virtually everyone will have an assignment by the time he or she is in the services for 5 or 6 years within the military commission structure. We have had more chief prosecutors in the military commissions than we've had trials in the military commissions in 9 years. The turnover rate and the impact and the resources that our military legal corps is putting into these commissions, which are not happening, is a drain on the rest of the duties that they have in military criminal justice, in the prosecution of war crimes, and in support of military operations that are increasingly difficult to manage legally. And that's all the time I have. Thanks, and let's turn it over to Rob.
Rob?
Thank you, Professor Hillman. Let me go from the sublime to the practical, if I may. It reminds me of a story. Soon after we indicted Zacarias Moussaoui in December 2001 in Alexandria, a couple other AUSAs and I were visited by the chief prosecutor from the newly minted tribunals that were to be held in Guantanamo Bay, and we sat down in our office in Alexandria and said to him, "Yes, sir, what can we do for you?" And he said, "Well, why don't you give me all your evidence?" And we said, "Why?" And he said, "Because within a couple of weeks, you guys won't have Moussaoui. We're going to move him into the military. He'll be moved in the military system, and we'll have him and others tried, sentenced, and executed before you'll ever get this thing off the ground in the civilian court system." Well, about 3 years later, a different chief prosecutor came to visit us in Alexandria. It's a Marine Corps Lieutenant Colonel, and he came in and he said, it turns out the Marines were really good at launching amphibious landings and other things like that, but we're not so good at administering judicial system. Can you help us with this?" And we've tried to in one form or another since then. But we lived through the Moussaoui case for about 4.5 years with the notion that at any time a learned decision might be handed down from the bench or the executive branch may tell us, "Well, we're giving up on the civilian trial of this guy. He's going to go to Gitmo." And the joke among us, and I think among the defense also, was that you could hear the sound of the Black Hawk helicopter coming to land at the Alexandria, Virginia Detention Center to take him away. But it didn't happen. I guess I have a couple of additional points to make. Number one, key to doing this in the civilian system is the Classified Information Procedures Act. And I think we, and formerly the Eastern District of Virginia, and I think the Southern District of New York and some other places as well, think there is a well-settled practical application of SEPA that permits these trials to occur in the civilian judicial system. Basically, you need to work out pre-trial what classified national security information is going to be able to be exposed to light of a public trial and in what form. The manner in which you've done this has been sort of developed through espionage cases and terrorism cases. You get cleared defense counsel like Ed McMahon here, a terrorism defendant who has no clearance, and that's unlike a typical espionage case, will not get access in most cases to classified material. And finally, I would add that SEPA ought to be applied flexibly to permit the trial of these types of cases in the civilian judicial system. Most notably in the Moussaoui case, of course, that came to be applied in permitting substitute testimony for held enemy combatants who were held at that point abroad that was allowed to be submitted to the jury. And I know Ed will have something to say about that as well. I might add also that SEPA is not a sword for the prosecution. If you go into a national security case, either as a prosecutor, you ought to know that you're entering a two-front war. You've got the defense lawyers to take on, and you've got the intelligence community to take on, because the CIA and the NSA does not want to let you, as a prosecutor, use the best stuff they have. You go in knowing that the best information you have will never see the light of day in a trial, and SEPA is not set up, it's set up to allow to work out what the defense needs and is relevant to conduct a constitutionally permissible defense. It's not to allow the prosecution to use the best sources and methods information from the intelligence community. I would also add that I told Professor Goldsmith that I would raise this today, is that my view is that, let's put aside for 1 second talking about KSM and Ramzi bin al-Shib and Mustafa Ahmed al-Hassawi and some of the bigger 9/11 conspirators, and talk about the more run-of-the-mill terrorism case that's prosecuted in the Article III courts. Typically, and Judge Brinkman has had a number of these, you'll have material support for terrorism. The typical case is, I'll give you an example, some people from Northern Virginia go over and train in the al-Qaeda training camps and are captured abroad or home, brought back, often U.S., typically U.S. citizens, come back and they're charged with material support for terrorism. The way that we typically prove those is to get a witness who said, "Look, I saw Ed McMahon in the Al-Farouk training camp." That's material support for terrorism. That essentially makes our case for us. But sometimes those cooperating witnesses are held by foreign governments, and they're not going to let that flipped al-Qaeda person come to, for instance, Sacramento and testify. And so what we did in the Moussaoui case under Judge Brinkema's rulings and guidance is, for example, we took the videotaped deposition on a live secure video link from a prison in Singapore of a guy named Faiz Bafana. The defense lawyers were there, the prosecutors were there. Moussaoui confronted Faiz Bafana via a live encrypted two-way video link, and we played the recording of that for the jury in the death penalty sentencing hearing in Virginia. Now, that is a flexibly applied view of the Confrontation Clause. And some justices and some courts across the country don't hold that view. But in my view, that type of evidence is necessary if we're going to try sort of run-of-the-mill terrorism cases in the Article III courts. I might add to address Jack's point of whether these are genuine trials. My view, having lived and sweated through the Moussaoui case for a number of years, is that it was worth it. And it was worth it on a number of fronts. It was worth it because the system worked. And I think Judge Brinkman may touch on this. Even Moussaoui himself admitted that the system worked. We got a look at him. He spoke publicly. We got a view of how he reveled in the misery and horror that he created in America, helped create. And we got a view of what motivated this person and what we are up against. It also provided a venue for some catharsis for victims to come in and testify. And above all, I think we showed that we could do it. And that's my final point. Thank you very much.
Thank you, and I've never been to the training camp in Pakistan since this is being televised. I don't want anybody to leave that one hanging out there. You know, Rob and I went through this trial, and Judge Brinkham as well, obviously, but you know, Rob and I are working on this thing day to day, and one thing I think gets lost in the academic debate about Moussaoui's case and the 9/11 cases is really justice for all the family members. Rob and I had to almost live with some of these people, and there's, you know, 3,000 victims, more than that if you add the embassy bombing and the coal bombing as well. And so while you discuss academic and practical questions about this, because of various decisions that have been made, there's people just yearning for justice out there. And I know Rob, I'm out of the government, still probably hears, as I do, from a lot of these people. So, you know, when you try one of these cases, you can't lose track of that. Even as a defense lawyer, you've got to remember that, I think, at all times if you're going to be effective. But for me, the lesson from the Moussaoui trial, and I've also worked in Guantanamo as well on the 9/11 case, is that the government has to decide whether it really wants to have a trial or not. The idea of having a trial where the president says, I guarantee a death sentence before it starts, or the attorney general says, we're not going to lose, that's not a trial in the United States. And you know, as a defense lawyer in federal court, you don't get a whole lot of wins. You get used to losing. But you don't want to be told by the president before you even start that you're going to lose. And so what happens is that the trials that we've had in the Moussaoui case, which was a great trial in the sense of public disclosure of what happened, what led up to it, family members in the room, learning what really happened at the CIA and the FBI and other places. But it still wasn't, in my judgment, a fair trial because of what the CIA did. And I think if any of you read the paper this morning, just this morning the CIA announced that there's 3 more tapes of the interrogation of Ramzi bin al-Shib. 9 years later, after telling Judge Brinkema under oath that there were none, and after they were destroyed, now what kind of a trial is that, where we have this kind of evidence even 9 years later coming out? But when the government started to capture the 9/11 terrorist, we learned about it by reading the Washington Post, of course, which is where you get most of your classified information in Washington. And we began to ask for access to the witnesses. And Judge Brinkham found that the testimony was necessary for a fair trial, and she ordered us to take depositions to try to figure out some way to get this evidence before the jury. The Fourth Circuit reversed after Judge Brinkham has struck the death penalty. And based upon representation, I've never seen the affidavits. By the way, I know that Rob didn't draft these affidavits. I've never accused him of being involved in this. But the Fourth Circuit issued an opinion based upon, and of course we asked, how are these witnesses being interrogated? And the Fourth Circuit issued an opinion that said, we had to tell the jury that although you do not have the ability to see the witness's demeanor as he testifies, you must approach these statements with the understanding that they were made under circumstances designed to elicit truthful testimony from the witnesses. Now, we didn't know at that time what it was, how they were all being interrogated, but not last year, there's a man named Mohammed Khatani in Guantanamo, who is the real 20th hijacker, and he can't even be prosecuted because of the way He was interrogated. The military commission won't go ahead of him. And according to the judge in that case, the circumstances designed to elicit truthful statements from Mr. Catani included 160 days of continual contact only with interrogators, 48 to 54 consecutive days with 20-hour interrogations, standing naked in front of a female agent, subject to strip searches and insults to his mother and sister, threatened with a military dog, forced to wear a woman's bra, and had a thong placed on his head during the course of his interrogation, and with a leash tied to his chains, led around the room, and forced to perform dog tricks. Now, that's child's play compared to what happened from what's publicly reported to Khalid Sheikh Mohammed and the others. Literally, that's child's play compared to what happened to the others. And because the CIA decided not to disclose this, we had a very serious death penalty trial where the truth really wasn't told to the jury as to what happened. And that's just something. If we're going to have these trials, whether they're in commissions, whether they're in federal court, there's got to be a decision made at the highest level of government that full disclosure of what's going to happen. You cannot, I think everyone on this panel would agree that you cannot have a death penalty trial consistent with the Eighth Amendment in which all things that have happened to the defendant in his life are not put forward. And if they're uncomfortable to the CIA, that's too bad, but they're going to come out. Now, the Guantanamo courts, I can tell you from, at least in my judgment, are really the worst form of law that we've ever come up with. They just have no respect around the world, for one thing. And these are very important trials, as I start out with, for the truth to come out, for people all over the world to see it. And a lot of it has to do with the infrastructure. In the 9/11 trial, I can't remember, Judge, I think you called 800 jurors in the Moussaoui case? They called 25 in Guantanamo to try to seat a jury in that case. They have, I don't think the JAG Corps has a single death-qualified lawyer. If there is one, I don't know who it is. And that the new fix from the Obama administration is to require the presidents of death penalty lawyers in the Guantanamo trials. And the same statute prohibits payment of non-JAG lawyers to perform the services. And add to that, Congress just passed a bill to investigate lawyers in Guantanamo for supposedly endangering national security. I don't know anybody that's going to go down there and participate in those trials if those are the circumstances that go forward. And the courtroom itself, if you want a public trial, is actually sealed off. The people in the audience are on behind a piece of glass. They can't hear the proceedings. It's on 45-second delay. Someone from the CIA sits in the courtroom, and if somebody gets close to saying something classified, they hit a switch, and the whole courtroom goes dark. And everybody looks up. What happened? Who said what? What was this? And it's really ridiculous in terms of having a public trial at all. I told Rob earlier that one time Khalid Sheikh Mohammed mentioned a conversation or some relationship between Richard Nixon and Pat Buchanan, and the machine turned off. And all of us were shocked to know what that was, but it turned out that the agent had just sat on the button is what it was. So, and I'll point out, one of they don't have any translators in Guantanamo that can really do real-time translation. In the 9/11 trial, they don't all speak the same dialect and everything, and nobody can hear what's going on. You've got Khalid Sheikh Mohammed, who speaks five languages, correcting the interpreters. No, no, stop, nope. You know, it's just a farce in terms of how you know, Judge Brinkman, any of you judges would run a trial like that. You wouldn't start the day in court without a translator. You wouldn't just leave it up to chance. And I think I've reached the end of my time, and I also wanted to say one last thing, that Rob and I did have to come all the way to Hawaii to speak before Judge Brinkema once in our lives.
Well, I'm here to give you the judge's perspective on trying these types of cases in Article III courts, and to sum it up in a nutshell, I think we absolutely can do it. We can do it with the existing procedural tools that we have, perhaps having to be a little creative in how we use them. But I think of the Moussaoui case as an extremely good empirical example of how the system does in fact work. Now, I don't know whether you have heard this joke before or not, but it's actually quite an accurate one. Do you know the difference between a terrorist and an Article III judge? You can negotiate with a terrorist. That's an extremely... I say that because those of you, colleagues, judicial colleagues who get cases like this, need to remember that. There's an incredible amount of control that we have as Article III judges, and often you have to use it in these cases. I want to just quickly tick off the key structural elements of the Moussaoui case, which I think would represent the ultimate perfect case. Perfect being complete, as in The Perfect Storm. Those of you who have read the book or seen the movie. In that book, you know, two massive storms came together and formed one colossal perfect storm. And in a case like Moussaoui in KSM, if he were ever to be prosecuted, and his colleagues, if he were ever to be prosecuted in Article III court, you'd have another sort of perfect case. Because the Moussaoui case involved aspects which, for anybody who's been a trial judge or a trial lawyer, you know are going to greatly increase the complexity and challenges of that case. You have a pro se defendant who is extremely hostile to the government and doesn't trust anybody. In the Moussaoui case, and he was allowed to go pro se for a while, ultimately it was withdrawn, his status was withdrawn, but it became so strange that it was not uncommon for Moussaoui to file a pro se pleading in which Rob Spencer and the prosecutors would agree and standby defense counsel would write the opposition. How many times have you seen the prosecution aligned with the defendant and defense counsel being the opponent? But those things happened in that case, in part because Moussaoui so distrusted the system that he was convinced that his counsel were there to guarantee that he be convicted and sentenced to death. It was a death penalty case. Now, most terrorism cases in this country are not death eligible. But anybody, any judge who's tried a death case knows that by their very nature, they're extremely complicated. They have totally different rules about the number of jurors, the number of peremptories. They have to be tried in various stages. So it's a much more complicated case. In addition, as Rob mentioned, there is frequently, and there was certainly in the Moussaoui case, classified information. Now, the really strange thing that happened in Moussaoui is that what was classified was not the traditional issue that comes up in national security cases. SIPA, which is the Classified Information Procedures Act, which was referenced by Rob, was modeled on a concept of espionage cases, where you had somebody who had a clearance, worked at the Pentagon or the CIA, and was leaking or giving out government secrets, documents. That's been the traditional model. In the Moussaoui case, the classified information became human beings. That is, when KSM and the others were arrested, and as Ed said, we all knew about it from the front pages of the Washington Post, at that time, the United States government was not officially acknowledging that they had these people in their custody. Now, we would have Moussaoui, who read the paper, say, I want to hear from KSM. He will tell you what my role or non-role was in September 11th, and this is a very important issue in a capital case because the role the defendant plays in the crime is critical to whether or not he is death eligible. So Moussaoui knew the names of these people. Moussaoui had read in the Post they'd been arrested. He wanted access to them. The government wouldn't even let us sometimes use their names of these people, and they would black out the name. You know, the defendant requested access to, and you see a black 2 inches in the pleading, because that was so classified. It became very strange how you balance that kind of classification. And what I did in that case is I took the SIPA statute and tried to carve out a way of balancing, which we could talk about in individual questions maybe down the road. But anyway, anytime you have classified information in a case, it greatly increases its complexity. But again, trial judges all over the country have dealt with SIPA matters, have dealt with death cases, have dealt with hostile defendants who are pro se. Because of the nature of terrorism cases, there will be extraordinary security concerns. And in the Moussaoui case, it wasn't just the external security, keep the building safe from attack, also keep the building safe from victims who might have very strong views about the case and want to attack Mr. Moussaoui or otherwise disrupt the proceedings. But I also was concerned, and I called this security, about maintaining the decorum of the trial. There were commentators who wanted to call it a circus because Moussaoui would often speak out and do some rather outrageous things in the courtroom. But I felt it was extraordinarily important because of the public exposure of that case to keep the internal security, that is the decorum in the courtroom, absolutely pristine. And in most cases, I think we were successful. It's already been alluded to, there were thousands of victims, which create a whole different dynamic. And as many of you know, there had been precedent in the Oklahoma City bombing case when Timothy McVeigh was prosecuted. They changed venue in that case, and Congress was concerned because there had been so many victims, although compared to the September 11th, it was, you know, just a minuscule amount of victims, but still there were several hundred in the Oklahoma City area. They wanted them to have access to the trial proceedings, and the federal in the federal system, trials cannot be videoed. So there was a law passed by Congress that required that there be closed circuit video available to the victims. That added a whole additional level of complexity, and I think if KSM and his colleagues were prosecuted in an Article III court, there would be a similar requirement so that the victims could have access. And lastly but not least, there was both extraordinary national and international media interest in the case. Our legal system was significantly on trial in that case. Moussaoui was a French citizen, so the French press was particularly interested. But because of just the nature of the case, we had people everywhere from Al Jazeera on up, you know, who wanted to cover it. And it was very important in that kind of a case to make sure that that things were done appropriately. So those were the challenges that we had in the Moussaoui case. The ultimate conclusion of the Moussaoui case was that the jury system, in its all of its brilliance, did not agree unanimously on the death penalty. One juror, you know, 12 angry men, those of you who've seen the movie, it really is true. One juror held out. He was just not convinced beyond a reasonable doubt that Moussaoui was eligible for the death penalty, in part because he felt that he had not heard all of the relevant information. And because of that juror, Moussaoui was sentenced to life imprisonment without the possibility for parole. I think it's incredibly interesting to get the final word on the Moussaoui trial from Moussaoui himself, because it's quite extraordinary. He had pled guilty, and so what was tried was the penalty. Again, with a capital case, there are multiple layers to the trial. But 4 or 5 days after the verdict came in, he filed a motion to withdraw his guilty plea and attached an affidavit to it in which he said at the very end, "I was extremely surprised when the jury did not return a verdict of death because I knew that it was the intention of the American justice system to put me to death. I had thought that I would be sentenced to death on the emotions and anger toward me for the deaths on September 11. But after reviewing the jury verdict and reading how the jurors set aside their emotions and disgust for me and focused on the law and evidence that was presented during the trial, I came to understand that the jury process was more complex than I assumed, because I now see that it is possible that I can receive a fair trial even with Americans as jurors, and that I have the opportunity to prove that I did not have any knowledge of and was not a member of the plot to hijack planes and crash them into buildings on September 11, 2001. I wish to withdraw my guilty plea and ask the court for a new trial to prove my innocence of the September 11 plot." And it was signed, as he always did, "Slave of Allah, AKA Zacarias Ibn Omar Moussaoui al-Sahrawi." And that was his view of the trial. Thank you.
Thanks very much. Do any of you want to comment on any of the other presentations before I ask some questions? No? Okay. Then let me start off by asking about the main alternative to civilian trials, and that is the military commission system. Beth mentioned how difficult it's been for the JAG Corps to operate in this system, and I think, although I want you to comment on this, it's because they've been raised in a culture of and educated in, and they're completely absorbed in the culture of the Uniform Code of Military Justice. So I think it would be useful to know, if you can tell us, Beth, why we need an alternate form of military justice from the UCMJ. What's the perceived need, whether UCMJ trials could be used for terrorist cases? And then, Ed, I'm wondering if you think, you've been very critical of military commissions, whether you think that the UCMJ process would be a good alternative. So,
legally, the UCMJ could certainly be used to try alleged terrorists. And if there was a need to make any particular changes in it, Congress could amend the statute, as it frequently does, actually, to address particular crimes, if that were necessary. But I don't think that it is. To me, the reason that I think the commissions have been such a hardship for judge advocates is not only were the senior leaders of the Judge Advocate General's Corps not consulted in the initial versions of military commissions, but the tried and true, the common law developed over time, statutorily driven, precedent heavy military justice system, in effect, since the UCMJ was adopted by Congress in 1950 and went into effect in 1951 in the midst of a war in Korea. All that time we've had and built a military justice system that was chucked as a possible solution to this issue of how to try these persons. And judge advocates have experience in that system and are familiar with it, and it is heavily civilianized. The civilianization of military law, of military criminal justice, has been a major trend in the post-World War II period, not only with the UCMJ, but with subsequent reforms in military law since then. Our judge advocate corps, by the way, is the most selective it's ever been right now. We had, I think the Army has the biggest corps of judge advocates, about 1,700. The Navy's is the smallest. The Navy had the biggest increase in applications over the last few years. They've had a 100% increase in the number of people applying to be in the Navy JAG. This is not so much a testament to the attractiveness of military legal practice as it is to the job market out there for young attorneys, but it is a sign of persons interested in public service and also a sign of the opportunities that military legal practice offers. But I think the UCMJ certainly could have been used. And in fact, the judges on the Court of Appeals for the Armed Forces, 5 appointed judges, Article I judges, appointed to 15-year terms on the Court of Appeals for the Armed Forces, are experienced in many of the same issues that attend to these trials. They're trying war crimes trials right now. They are hearing appeals from death penalty cases in the military. And notwithstanding, Ed rightly points out, it has been a real difficulty for the military's JAG Corps to maintain expertise in death-eligible cases. There are some reserve judge advocates who are certified, but I don't think that the active duty JAG does have death-certified attorneys right now, because there just haven't been that many cases that have gone forward. But I think the UCMJ could be used.
But I've had several of the military folks call me and consult about how I tried Moussaoui, and I was shocked at some of the things that we have as Article III judges available to us that they don't. For example, if you have an unruly defendant, and Moussaoui at times would want to stand up and yell and speak inappropriately. And again, my concern about controlling him in the courtroom, we used a stun belt on him whenever he was in court. I never have had a defendant shackled, but I think you have to have a way of controlling a defendant who is potentially going to be uncontrollable. And I have found, I've used it 2 or 3 times in difficult cases, that it works beautifully. It's basically a belt, like a small girdle that's put around the waist. It's under the clothing, so it can't be seen. The person is shown a little video by the marshals about what happens if the buzzer is pressed. They get a shock. And quite frankly, when you get that shock, you can lose control of your bodily functions. I mean, you can be embarrassed. And most of the terrorists and serious criminals I've dealt with do have a certain sense of dignity. And the last thing you want in a public courtroom is to be, you know, on the ground, moving around, and perhaps, you know, soiling yourself. And once I've had that belt put on a defendant, I've never had a problem with them. They were amazed that we could do this. And I think Ed's had that experience, right? That when he's been down in Guantanamo, he tells me that there are almost no restraints at all on these people. Is that right?
Yeah, there's no in the 9/11 case, there was no restraints whatsoever. Physical restraints on any of the defendants at any time. Now, that said, there's also about 15 armed soldiers standing on the wall as well. But when I first got there, I was really shocked. They didn't even give a security briefing, because the marshals were great protecting the defense lawyers, too, in Moussaoui's case. And they would tell us, watch for this, don't give him a pen, like this kind of a pen he could kill you with if he wanted to. They have special pens for them. And when we got to Guantanamo, there were no briefings at all, not a single one about what to do if something happened in the courtroom, where to go or anything. And I don't think that they're as concerned about it down there.
Well, and the other thing is, unless I misunderstand the way the military law is structured, that system cannot take a guilty plea that exposes someone to the death penalty. Now, that's critical in these cases because KSM, as I understand it, has tried to plead guilty several times, but he wants to be guaranteed the death penalty. If he came into my court and wanted to plead guilty to a capital case, just as Moussaoui did, that plea could be accepted. He'd get a standard Rule 11 colloquy, and then we would address the penalty phase. But the military folks, our hands are tied in that respect. So, I mean, there are still some real structural differences between the two.
Do you want to say anything else? Go ahead.
I just wanted to throw out, I do believe that what you're pointing to are really issues in high-profile criminal trials,
right.
And the federal criminal bench has much more experience with that than American military justice. But that does go only to a small number of persons who we might try before the commissions. I mean, most of the persons who are facing all the commissions that we've had so far, they involve drivers and cooks and child soldiers. They don't involve the high-profile criminal defendants where we have these very issues at stake.
Of course, the other irony is, I think the ordinary public impression is that military justice would somehow be harsher. I hate to say this, but the dirty little secret is I think that the Article III system is tougher. And I'm thinking of the case of Hamdan, who got a five-year sentence with basically time served. Had he been in Eastern District of Virginia and convicted of those same offenses, I suspect he could easily be doing 20 to life. I mean, the sentence would have been completely different. And so it's ironic when you look at the outcome of the few cases that have been through the military system and compare them to the outcomes in our court. I have many, many defendants who are serving life sentences in cases that did not involve any actual violence other than they were shooting RPGs or other types of really dangerous weapons at training camps over in Pakistan. So it's interesting when you think about it. I think the perception of the two systems has somehow become warped.
Yeah, and the other thing to add to that is that no terrorism defendant in the United States, I mean, the modern times, ever gotten the death sentence either. So nobody, the embassy bombing people, they're not a single death penalty has been so, and the Attorney General promises one, he's fighting against the tide.
So let me ask what you think about the claim by two different governments now that someone acquitted at trial in civilian or military trial can still be detained under a military detention rationale. On the one hand, there are precedents, Supreme Court precedents, that say that there's no ultimate due process or Eighth Amendment hurdle to detaining someone after acquittal or after sentences run if there's an independent basis for preventative detention for dangerousness or something like that. On the other hand, those precedents have not been applied for detention of the length and indefiniteness that I think we're talking about. And also, I don't believe that in any of those cases the executive branch announced beforehand that under no circumstances would the defendant be released. Now, ultimately, I suppose that's going to be a question for courts, but I'm just to decide. But and we may never have to actually address the issue if there are no acquittals. But I'm just wondering what you think about the impact on a trial of that position of the executive branch. Any of you, Rob? That's what I meant when I was asking about the legitimacy of the trial. I didn't mean inherently. I was talking about with that kind of background assumption.
Yeah, I took it as that. I still I mean, there's. And I don't know the answer to your question. It certainly undercuts it from the international perspective. And it appears to be a show trial if that's all we're doing. I guess another question is what happens to the jury pool if that's the answer.
Well, I think I would do the same thing I would if I had the case. I'd do the same thing I did with the Moussaoui case. I mean, you have to honestly talk to the jury. You know, I'm a great believer in the American jury system. I think our jurors really do take their job seriously. I think it's important for judges to explain to the jurors, though, exactly what their job is. I always tell jurors, prospective jurors, that they're going to become judges. And I don't have a robe that I can give them to wear while they're sitting in my courtroom, but they should think of themselves as a judge, because their job is to judge the facts of the case. And then I tell them, think about what do you expect of a good judge? You want a man or a woman who's coming into that courtroom with an open mind, who absolutely has no predisposition one way or the other on the issues, and who has the time to give to the case, to think about it carefully, not to rush to judgment. And I give them a spiel like that. And I think that jurors, when they truly understand the significance of what they're going to do, is important. And if I had that case, I might even say, many of you may have read, that everyone expects a certain outcome in this case. Regardless of what you've seen in the media, you are the judges, and you're going to decide this case. Can you do that? And jurors, Americans rise to that kind of a challenge. I think it's important, the trial judge has to set that tone. That's why, again, I always go back to that business about Article III judges. You know, we really are very powerful, and we can't be afraid to use that power. You really have to be authoritarian in that courtroom. And you have to be a little bit of a teacher, too, because most jurors really are coming into your courtroom having watched things on television or in the movies. It's still not the real thing, and it's really important to take them step by step through the process, especially in important cases. The other thing I always tell jurors is, I refer to Hamlet, and I say, you know, during the course of a trial, even a capital case, there may be moments when something happens that's funny, and we laugh, and it happened in the Moussaoui case. I mean, it's a human enterprise, a trial. And I tell the jurors, remember, in Hamlet, there is comic relief, the greatest tragedy of the English language. There's comic relief. It doesn't mean the whole play isn't a tragedy. It just means this is a human enterprise where sometimes people laugh. You try to set the tone for the jurors so they really understand what we in this courtroom are going to be doing together. And so I think even if the president thinks the outcome is a done deal, it isn't if we set the right tone in the courtroom.
Ed, do you have any comments on this?
Yeah, I would say if you were the appointed defense lawyer in the case, you would do everything you could to get that in front of the jury because of the issue of future dangerousness of the defendant. Mm-hmm. In Moussaoui's case, Rob and I were talking earlier, you could never tell the jury he was going to get out someday. You know, one day you might see him walking down the street and you'll say hi.
That also points out why these death cases, why death changes everything. A death penalty case is different because for every argument you might think of that's going to lead the jury to think the person's guilty, that you can turn that around, you get a little reverse psychology on whether the death penalty ought to be applied.
Right, and so we would tell the jury in that situation that, you know, the Attorney General doesn't care what you think, nobody cares what you think, but it doesn't really matter what you do because he's going to be held anyway. So why bother to go through all this expensive time and process of giving him the death sentence when they're just going to hold him anyway? And then Rob would object to the argument, and we'd figure out. But I think you go back to, we were talking about the political interference earlier with the judicial process. If you have some kind of a statement out there to that effect, somebody's gonna figure out a way to use it in the trial if they can. And there's no rules of evidence whatsoever in the penalty phase of a federal death penalty trial. We paid videotapes of Condoleezza Rice testifying at the 9/11 commission, and you just go on and put on anything you want. I don't know how you would keep it out.
Yeah. Let me ask this, and then I think we'll turn it over for questions after this one from the audience. So one argument against the use of civilian trials is that Judge Brinkman talked about the creative use of rules in civilian terrorism cases because they present such different issues, and you talked about we've talked about the SEPA issues and how that's had to be modified, the terrorism cases. Confrontation clause issues are very difficult, and I think it's fair to say that there's been some new law developed in the confrontation clause. The Padilla case in Miami relied on a very, very broad conception of conspiracy. So some people think that the imperative to convict in civilian trials will lead to the contraction of defendants' rights that will spill over into non-terrorism cases. And I think that this is a reason for separating off the terrorism cases from non-terrorism cases. So I'm wondering, Judge Brinkman, but really anyone on the panel, what you think of that argument, whether it's a valid concern and how much of a concern it is.
Well, I think that's one of the few really legitimate arguments. That is, if we tamper with the rules or stretch them too far, have we watered them down and then created bad precedent that might leak into other types of cases? But the other problem, or the flip side of that, is if we start creating special adjudicatory systems for crime, what I worry about is the expansion of this military justice approach. We use the word war in so many concepts here. Narco-terrorism is a big word right now. And you know, you have significant organized criminal activity in Mexico and Latin America, creating havoc in those countries, much of it beginning to leak into our border states. So why would you not start thinking about maybe we should put narco-terrorists into this terrorism system? Probably the biggest threat we have in this country right now is from cyber terrorism. People abroad who could literally shut down our banking system or our airplanes or whatever, a very, very potentially serious area of criminal activity, organized criminal activity, much of it coming perhaps from abroad. Are we going to start creating a special system of justice for those types of cases? It's a very slippery slope, in my view, when we start creating separate systems. Again, I may be old-fashioned, but I think Article III courts have worked in the past, and I think they can continue to work. We do have to be careful, and that's what the Courts of Appeals, quite frankly, and the Supreme Court is here for, is to make sure that in addressing these cases in Article III courts, we don't go too far. But that would be my approach to that question.
Any other thoughts on that? Anyone?
Okay, why don't we take some questions from the audience? I've been asked by Judge Smith and the committee to urge you, indeed to insist, that you ask questions and not give speeches, please, and that you try to keep them brief, because we do have an extraordinary panel here with extraordinary knowledge. So I urge you to ask questions, concrete questions, try to keep them brief so we can get as many questions as possible. Yes, sir. Is there a microphone? Sorry.
What do you think of the third system that you didn't talk about, the sort of indefinite detention without any kind of trial?
I have views on that, but does anyone on the panel want to speak to that?
Well, I could say that if you were appointed to represent somebody in a death penalty trial and Rob called me and said, I'm going to hold this guy forever and not try to execute him, I'd say thank you. And that would be the end of the case. And that would be your ethical obligation as a defense lawyer, would be to say that all these cases are about the sentence, whether it's life or death. And so, you know, that's an ethical answer to your question instead of a legal one. But if, that would be, I think, the view of most death eligible defense lawyers would be, that's fine. Just for this guy, though. I don't agree to it for anybody else. So, I mean, there may be a different legal answer to it than that.
So I'll give you briefly, since I'm a moderator and not a panelist, what I think the justification is for the third model, military detention. There's no doubt that the president has the authority, in my opinion, to detain members of the enemy during wartime. That was a power that was affirmed in Hamdi, actually, although it was limited to a traditional battlefield technically. But many lower courts have now held that the authorization to use military force triggers the president's powers to detain until the end of the conflict. The problem, so that by itself should be uncontroversial, I think. The problems are, and there are many, and I'll be brief, are one, that the end of the conflict here is genuine, literally indefinite, and two, that there's a heightened possibility of mistaken determinations in this conflict than in past conflicts. And when you combine those two principles, that means that there's a heightened possibility of putting someone away indefinitely by mistake. And for that reason, in my opinion, the traditional power remains, and as I say, many courts have held this, but we have to develop much different, much more heightened procedures to ensure or to minimize the possibility of mistake. And frankly, that's what we've been moving towards. We've been moving towards a system for the last 8 years through Congress has been involved a bit, but mostly through judicial development, of insisting on higher and higher showings by the government to prove that the person actually is an enemy combatant. And whether we've reached the right level or not, I don't know, and the Supreme Court hasn't weighed in on that yet, but that's the basic justification and rationale for military detention. Other questions?
Hi, I'm the U.S. Attorney from Oregon, and my question is this. The Justice Department has been very effective. I think that thinking about these just as death-eligible cases is wrong. It's all these little cases that happen that are harder nuts to crack in some ways. And we've been very effective. We've incarcerated or incapacitated some 400 people since September 11th and developed sources and prevented plots. So my question in the civilian system, my question is this, if you're gonna create this alternative system, how do you sort who goes into that alternative system in a way that doesn't undercut the effectiveness that the civilian systems had in those ways, and that doesn't cast doubt upon the fact or the credibility of either system? So like whether you're just sending the hard cases over there. I guess it's mainly for Jack and Ed and Professor Hillman.
Anyone want to address that?
Well, I'll address it briefly. I mean, I'm a believer in the use the tools in your toolbox approach. But I think you're right that you can, if you go too far one way or the other, too much toward a commission or too much toward Article III courts, you undercut the other one. I told a story after when the military chief prosecutor came to see me and said, we're going to get Moussaoui and everybody else in the military commission. And the power very much was toward, that's the way we're going to treat all terrorists. And now it's swung way back in the other direction. You know, I think I share the views of Judge Brinkman here that that's where it belongs. But I think we've still got to retain one of the other two systems to deal with the KSMs of the world.
I think this is a big problem, the kind of whether we can develop principal criteria to send different alleged terrorists into different systems. I don't think the government has a great answer to that yet. It does have the appearance of, to say, lack of principle. You have some of the most serious terrorists getting much more process and getting much more process before they're incapacitated than some of the lower level terrorists who get less process to be detained in the military detention system. And so I think it does threaten to have the appearance of unfairness, but again, the government has these legitimate tools. It has the very hard task of trying to incapacitate the terrorists, and it has so far successfully, two governments now argued that there hasn't been any challenges, I think, to the use of the different system for different alleged terrorists. And I don't see an alternative to it for reasons Rob said going forward. Did you want to?
I'll just add briefly. To me, this is a part of what Judge Brinkman was pointing out when she mentioned the different categories of terrorists and alleged criminals that might be tried in different systems. I think the military commission system today shows us how incredibly difficult it is to build this system from scratch, and the risks associated with that, the costs, the resources, and the unjust outcomes that can result. I'd also just point out that I think in our past, Jack mentioned that we seem to have maybe a lack of principle or just a system of ad hoc decisions about where we'll try different persons right now. I think that that's long been the case with the use of commissions, that it has been relatively ad hoc. They've been decisions thrust upon political leaders faced with disciplinary challenges within occupied areas and also faced with real threats to the nation. I think that military commissions don't serve, their ends do not overlap precisely with the ends of federal criminal trials. They have different goals. I think one of the things we see as we study military commissions with more perspective historically is that they've been used as a substitute for force as much as they've been used as a truth-seeking, retributive justice sort of measure. So I think that the commissions are a different thing as well as being a potential substitute. And I don't think any of us are saying we think it's an especially appealing potential substitute.
Other thoughts? Other questions? Yes, sir. Could I ask you to, we have microphones on each side. If you want to ask a question, try to approach the microphone, please.
Real quick question. What would taking away the death penalty from all this do to the mix of the choices?
Very good question.
Well, it depending on specific cases, in the 9/11 cases, if the death penalty was off the table, the cases would be over, because the defendants would have pled guilty, been sentenced to life. And the issues of how they were interrogated and what happened to them, where they were, what they said, everything would be completely out the window. And the death penalty, it's not all these cases are death penalty cases, but and in the Moussaoui case, I'm sure Judge Brinkema, and she's already said that it was extraordinarily difficult to deal with it because it was a death penalty case. But death is different, and the rules that apply to it are completely different. As I was saying before, the military justice system and especially the commission system doesn't have the experience, they don't have the Eighth Amendment jurisprudence. And those sentences, if you try in a military commission, I think, and get a death sentence, these guys could sit there for years while those cases got appealed and all the way up to the Supreme Court, backwards and forwards. And so the trade-off, really, in terms of national security, the decision to try to seek the death penalty is extraordinary in these cases, what secrets are really on the line if that's what the government seeks. But every death penalty case, every federal death penalty case is very, very different from one when there's no death on the table. So,
Judge Brinkman, do you have anything to add to that?
No, I think Ed said the whole thing.
Other questions? Yes, could I ask you to come to the microphone? Thank you.
I understand the hesitation about creating a specialized court system with specialized rules, but would there be any value, does anyone think, to the proposal of having a panel of Article III judges like we have with the FISA court that would be designated judges throughout the nation who might have special training or experience, et cetera, in these kinds of cases that might be designated in different parts of the country to try them?
Well, the reality of it is that that's happening right now in the sense that these terrorism cases are being filed in almost every district. When Walker Lind and Moussaoui came into the Eastern District of Virginia, I think they were the first two post-September 11th cases that were brought. It looked for a while as though Virginia was going to become one of the sort of specialized terrorism courts. But I've been very pleased to see it spread around. I mean, you had the... Richard Reed was in Boston, Jose Padilla was tried in Miami. And the reality of it is now there's a significant body, a really significant body of Article III judges who have had experience with terrorism cases. The Federal Judicial Center has now phenomenal materials available to any Article III judge, including sample jury forms, verdict forms, all kinds of standing orders to help. So the answer is, I don't think you need a specialized bench. I think any competent Article III judge can handle these cases. The materials are out there, and as I said, the experience is out there now. I again think that we shouldn't tamper with something that's not broken. The Article III system of civilian justice, in my view, is not broken. It's working just fine. And if you start creating special groups of judges, I don't think that's a good idea. So I would leave it as it is.
Other thoughts? Other questions?
I didn't mean to chill people when I said you had to ask short questions and not give speeches. I didn't mean to chill you from asking questions. Yes, sir.
Jack, I'd like to direct this to you. Judge Brinkham raised the question about the cyber terrorism. You wrote a spectacular piece in the New Yorker a month or two ago, really addressing how that is got both civilian and military aspects to it. The issues that came up today, how do they apply in those sorts of cases?
About cyber terrorism?
Yes.
Yeah, I don't think, so this is a bit off point, but I don't think that, those issues yet intersect with these issues, the cyber terrorism issues, because the problem in the cyber terrorism cases is not what you do with the defendants, what you get them, but finding the defendants, because it's very hard to know who is responsible for some kind of cyber attack, and it's also very hard, they're usually offshore, to get them to this country. So I don't think that the type of trial issues we're talking about now are front and center in the cyber terrorism context. I do think that we're gonna have similar issues from the war on terrorism issues with the government being involved in the domestic homeland in the telecommunications and computer network, how far we want the government to go to keep us safe, how far we're going to allow them to be in the network, consistent with the Fourth Amendment and a number of statutes. That is an analogous issue to the one that applies in this terrorism context, and that will be a big issue. Other questions? I've got another one if no one else does. Do you have a question? No, you don't. Oh, sorry. Okay. So, sir, yes.
Is this on? I understand that in the 1980s, looking at other adjudicatory bodies to deal with terrorism, in the 1980s, Congress created a alien terrorist removal court, which I understand has basically never been used since it was created. Do we get any lessons from that as to sort of the failure of that body, why it hasn't been used, and what is that telling us about efforts to create new adjudicatory bodies and rules?
Rob, you know about that? I don't know much about the alien interpretation.
I really don't either, but I would draw the same lesson that Judge Brinkema just outlined from that, that we don't, I don't know that we need it. If it's serious terrorists, we've been able to deal with them in the Article III courts or one of the other options laid out by Jack.
Any other thoughts?
I don't know anything about it.
So let me ask a question about Miranda, because that's been in the news a lot. In connection with the Christmas Day bomber, the government gave him, I think within a day or two, read him his Miranda rights, and that caused a big political stir. And then within a couple of weeks, the Attorney General announced that the government might be seeking statutory authorization for a public safety exception to the Miranda warnings based on the Quarles case, which recognized a public safety exception to Miranda. So I guess the question is, does anyone on the panel have a comment or thoughts about that, and more generally, the importance of Miranda warnings? Is it a hurdle, or is Miranda a hurdle to terrorism trials, I guess is the question.
Well, obviously it would depend on the case, but in the case in Detroit, it seems to me, again, more kind of political meddling in the criminal justice system, because that case, they couldn't possibly need a confession to win that case. They've got people on the plane that saw him get on the plane. They got people on the plane that saw him light the fuse. They've got people that beat him up and took the bomb away from him. They've got pictures of him leaving with the bomb and probably screaming things. And you know what he said after that, I can't imagine remotely what it would have to do in terms of winning the case. So
how about more generally? I mean, it seemed, I don't know the answer to this question. It seemed to be a big deal, and certainly it's a big deal politically. And I'm wondering, in theory, is this a big deal for civilian courts, or is it more of a political issue?
My view practically is that it hasn't chilled statements from people detained for suspected of terrorism. And I think that for years, most of the terrorism investigation and prosecution work was done by the Southern District of New York, and they had a very, very good record of getting people, if they needed cooperators, for flipping them and getting them to testify and cooperate. I think we continued that in Alexandria. I see it as a theoretical or political issue more than an actual prosecutorial issue.
You agree with that, Judge?
I do.
Other thoughts?
In 2004, a Pakistani-born, naturalized American citizen, who was a truck driver from Ohio, who had been working with Al-Qaeda to case locations for a possible second attack. He'd gone up, and I think he'd looked at the Brooklyn Bridge. He'd looked at the tunnel under Baltimore and some places like that. The FBI found out about him, called him in to a hotel. I don't think he was ever in Hawaii, but he was kept in hotels and then eventually brought to Quantico. They debriefed him for days and days and days, worked out, got him a very experienced former prosecutor who was then a defense attorney, and he came into my court and he pled to a plea that exposed him to 20 years. It was not a binding Rule 11 plea, but it was a 20-year exposure. What was interesting in that case, and we've had some references to the political process, and what is so difficult from a judge's standpoint in many of these cases is that the war on terror is a political issue, and a lot of times the administration wants to get credit for looking aggressive and successful in this area. In the Farris case, part of the plea agreement had been that it would be under seal and kept secret, because this man had family left in Pakistan, and he was concerned that if it got out that he was cooperating with U.S. officials, that his family might be injured. So we took the plea under seal late on a Friday afternoon, and I got a call from the U.S. attorney at home, I think either that night or early the next morning, Judge, you're not going to like this, but it's in the front page of the Washington Post. And clearly, that had been somebody from the administration who had leaked it. As a result, Mr. Farris tried to withdraw his guilty plea. It totally turned him against the government. That's an example. That's just one example. But I mean, there are tons of examples of people who do work out deals. In the what was called the Virginia Jihad case, it involved nearly a dozen Northern Virginians who had gotten training in Pakistan. Several of those individuals cooperated with the government and got sentences. They all pled guilty to something, but between their cooperation and the lesser charges to which they pled, their sentences ranged from just a couple of years to maybe 10, whereas the people who went to trial and who were convicted, some were acquitted, but those who were convicted got much more serious sentences. So it's not at all uncommon, as in any other criminal enterprise, so you're dealing with an MS-13 gang case or any other kind of conspiratorial case, for the law enforcement people and the prosecutors to cut deals, hopefully with the lesser involved, to get their cooperation and then make the case against the more serious ones. In my experience, terrorism cases are no different than any other criminal case.
Yeah, there's also an example of from the embassy bombings case in the Southern District of New York, that they had at one point a pretty high-level al-Qaeda guy who turned and was testified and was put into the witness security program, pled guilty, but actually went into WITSEC.
The question is, if those who who cooperate plead guilty, do they go into the general population? It depends. I mean, a lot of defendants who are charged with terrorism charges often will have a SAM, a special administrative measure, placed on them by the Marshal Service, and that can carry over into the Bureau of Prisons. I think the Bureau of Prisons makes an individualized assessment as to each person. I do have people convicted of crimes that would be considered terrorism crimes who are in the general population. I also have several who are not. And so I think it depends on the individual person.
I just want to make a quick comment on the difference in the federal judiciary today versus the last times that we talk about commissions being so relevant in American history. This sort of experience was not evident in the federal judiciary in World War II or in the Civil War, nothing compared to the federal criminal infrastructure, for good and for ill, that we have today. So this level of expertise makes this dialogue very, very different than what it was in either of those situations.
Thank very you good. Very much. Let's give our panel a round of thanks. We hope you found this interesting, provocative, and perhaps a little out of the ordinary, because we deal in interesting times, and the Ninth Circuit is big enough that we're bound to get some interesting cases that sound in terrorism one way or another. I've been asked to remind you that the next presentation, Justice and the Underrepresented, will start at 10:15. As a result, and given the size of the group here, we're asking that you stand and relax between the sessions if you're going to attend the next session, rather than going out unless you obviously need to, so that they can start on time for the next session. We thank you very much for being here. Let's give our panel one more round of applause.